Hello and welcome to our second edition of Let's Talk. We're on a mission at GUTV. We want to address some of the crucial issues facing our society today in hopes of starting a conversation and maybe enacting some change. This week, we'll be focusing on mental health. Mental health is a person's condition in regards to their emotional and psychological well-being. Tonight, we'll explore mental health through the lens of personal stories and professional training. Gonzaga, let's talk. Good evening and welcome to Mind, Body, Spirit, Let's Talk. I'm Caroline Rourke. Tonight we're going to dive into a topic that many prefer to remain quiet about. We'll discuss the myths and stigmas behind mental health conditions. We'll also hear the story of a student who has experienced firsthand how these stigmas can affect someone's life. And finally, we'll introduce you to a few members of our campus community who are speaking out about mental health. We're going to address several different mental health conditions as well as their impact on individuals. One thing that directly impacts individuals with mental health conditions are the misconstrued ideas regarding a person in relation to their condition. So, we compiled a list of myths and stigmas regarding mental health and those who are affected by it. One of the most common stigmas surrounding mental illness is that people who are dealing with mental health issues are violent and unpredictable. This is a myth, and there are numbers to prove it. According to the Department of Health and Human Services, only 3 to 5% of violent acts can be attributed to people living with a serious mental illness. Actually, people with mental illness are 10 times more likely to be the victim of a violent crime than the general population. Another common stigma is that personality weakness or character flaws can cause mental health problems, that people with mental health issues can snap out of it if they try hard enough. This is not true. Mental health issues have nothing to do with the character of a person. A person is not mentally ill, they have a mental illness, and that illness can be caused by a variety of factors. Biological factors, such as genes, life experiences, such as trauma, and family history of mental health issues all contribute to mental health problems. Another serious misconception is that there is no hope for people who have mental illness. Once someone develops a mental health problem, he or she will never recover. Again, this is a myth. Studies show that people with mental health issues improve and often recover completely. In fact, there currently are more services, treatments, and community support systems than ever before. These are just a few of many misconceptions that our societal attitude towards mental health often perpetuates. As we begin to generate discussion about mental health conditions and those who suffer from them, please keep in mind that what you say matters. A person is not defined by their mental state, so that mental state should not be defined by stereotypes. Something else to consider when discussing the topic of mental health is the proper language to use. Many phrases and terms are offensive and incorrect, and they often stem from some of the stigmas that we just mentioned. When talking about mental health, try to keep these things in mind. Think about another diagnosis for any other problem. If a person is diagnosed with a mental health disorder, think about it just the way you would another. Just like a person isn't cancer, a person who has a mental health disorder isn't disabled or has a disorder. In a similar vein, a person with bipolar disorder or schizophrenia is not bipolar or schizophrenic. Keep these in mind as you start to generate the conversation. Another way society often adds to existing mental health misconceptions is by using terms like happy pills instead of referring to prescriptions as medications. And lastly, and most importantly, is the phrasing around suicide. In the past, it was widely acceptable to say that someone had committed suicide, successfully or unsuccessfully. But now, the psychiatric community has agreed that the correct verbiage should sound like attempted or attempted and completed suicide. The word committed is often associated with crime or other wrongdoings, and this emphasizes that suicide is not a crime that someone commits. It's a consequence of a mental health disorder. Please keep these phrases and terminology in mind when discussing mental health disorders, just as we'll try to use them properly throughout the rest of our program. We thought the only way to properly understand the effects that stigmas can have on an individual was to hear it from someone with firsthand experience.
A current Gonzaga student was willing to share her story regarding her own experience with depression, anxiety, bipolar disorder, and a sleep disorder. She not only shared her personal story, but she'd like to send a message to those who are so affected by stigmas that they're afraid to get the help that they deserve. She wished to remain anonymous, so we had a third party read her story for her.
It all started during junior year of high school. The stress built up, the inadequacy elevated, the anxiety set in, the depression evolved. Throughout all of my difficulties and wearying times, never did I think to seek comfort and aid in a professional. I was held back by the stigma of mental health conditions. I believed that feeling vulnerable meant that I was weak, that admitting to needing help meant that I was broken, and that succumbing to reliance upon someone else meant that I was dependent. When you are contained in this dismal place in your life, you solemnly convince yourself that you are capable of getting through every day because you know the outcome and the results. You are always sure of a few things. You understand that you will be exhausted from creating a facade to wear in front of your family and friends. You know how to deal with the consequences of hurting yourself. And you know how to hold yourself when you're trying to sleep, yet full of uneasiness. These behaviors by which I lived for over 4 years are not a life I would wish upon anyone. The first step to anyone's healing is crushing any and all stigmas held about mental health conditions. Mental health conditions are not mental illnesses. Be brave, not vulnerable. Heal and mend with family and friends by your side. Embrace yourself. Do not be turned away and embarrassed by your conditions. You are not defined by what society says about mental health conditions, and you are not expounded by your diagnosis. Today, there are so many stigmas that inhibit individuals from getting the necessary care during difficult times. It is important that we, as a student body, work to eradicate these stigmas so that every individual can receive the help and guidance that he or she is due.
Wow. You know, one of the things that really gets me about mental health issues is the privacy of them. Someone you know and love very, very well might be struggling, and you might not even know because they hide themselves so well. We want to thank this student for her courage, not only to share her own story, but to encourage others to share theirs. We hope that by doing so, we can help others, and maybe even you, who might be in a similar situation. We also encourage everyone to think twice about what they say to someone, because you might not ever know if they're struggling. Coming up, we'll introduce you to Christine Hoover, a professor in the Organizational Leadership Program who is doing her part to destigmatize mental health and instead help those who might be struggling. We'll also take a closer look at some of the resources available on Gonzaga's campus. But first, we want you to be a part of the conversation. Coming up after the break, our social media correspondent Lauren Banus will talk about ways to maintain your mental health. How do you find balance? Tweet in with the hashtag MindBodySpirit. You're watching Let's Talk on GUTV.
My minute for mental health. How does faith connect with mental health? Well, God has given us a wonderful gift called free will. We are able to choose how we respond to various situations. Many stressful situations get to us, including major setbacks, hurt feelings, severe disappointments. Because we have free will, we can say, stop, don't respond yet, but invite the Holy Spirit into our thoughts and into our hearts so that we can be enabled to respond in a healthy way. When we allow that time, we do maintain mental health and good decisions.
You're all right, man? Hello and welcome back to GUTV. I'm Lauren Banis here in the Opila Tweet Suite. In order to get people involved with our show, we wanted to have people tell us how they take care of their mind, body, spirit, their whole selves. So, using the hashtag MindBodySpirit, tweet in and let us know what you do to break up the busyness of your day and take care of your mental self. There's still time to tweet in and your show could be featured later. Your tweet could be featured later on in our show. But first, let's take a look at how one professor is combining nursing, business, art, and mental health. GUTV's Sila Del Rosario found out what it looks like when painting, management, and schizophrenia overlap.
Business management and mental health have a crossroads at Gonzaga University. Under the instruction of Associate Professor Christine Hoover, Management 350 students participated in a Foundation for Hospital Art Paint Fest. The Foundation for Hospital Art is a nonprofit organization with a quest to donate at least one painting to every hospital on Earth.
Our project specifically focused on hospitals that serve people struggling with mental health. We wanted to make sure that the idea of caring, of color, of life was a part of that healing process in our local community.
The Management 350 students spent one morning class period painting six canvases that comprise one collage to be displayed in Eastern State Hospital, a psychiatric health center in Medical Lake. They also attended a guest lecture on mental health with practicum nursing students. At the end of the process, the students were required to write a reflection that ties all the themes discussed together in a big picture.
And so this project very much talks about explicit management concepts students need to learn as a part of a principles of management class, and at the same time invites a greater awareness and openness to understanding these mental health issues. So the student reflections oftentimes note this air of surprise in engaging in an experiential class, in thinking about the actions that they want to take. And that, I think, is a part of what the Ignatian pedagogical paradigm is all about.
In the written reflection, one student wrote, "In the future, I will definitely see people with mental disorders for what they are, people. I think this is my biggest takeaway from this project, that people need to be treated fairly, no matter what societal connotations are present." Management 350's Foundation for Hospital Arts project brought together multiple disciplines for the sake of talking about the universal issue of mental health. Sila Del Rosario, GUTV.
I think that's the coolest thing. What a creative way to fulfill that Jesuit ideal of being men and women for others while also combining campus departments that might not otherwise have crossed paths. It's awesome. Once again, today's show is about fulfilling and taking care of the body, mind, body, and spirit, all three. And now, one way to do that is to pay attention to your mental health. Earlier this year, Gonzaga's Health Center conjoined with the Counseling Center, and not only do they have a new location, there's an expanded roster of therapists. It's a great free resource that's open for Gonzaga students to take advantage of. GUTV's Doug Taylor has more.
Libby Skiles is in her 17th month as Assistant Dean of Student Well-Being on campus. She oversees health and counseling services.
I'm essentially focused on students' well-being habits and how we can help them be healthy individuals and learn healthy skills that they can take with them when they leave Gonzaga.
Skiles says that students seek counseling for a wide variety of issues, both short and long-term.
Sometimes it's temporary challenges. They learned about they're having a relationship struggle, or they had a loved one who passed away. Maybe they're struggling in a particular class and starting to experience some anxiety for the first time. Other times it's more ongoing issues, some depression, anxiety. We see a lot of that.
She's also seen quite a bit of change in her short tenure. For one, the opening of the Hemmingson Center freed up space for student counseling to move their offices. Counseling moved to the Health Center this year, which means that no matter what the problem is, there's one place that students can go.
It's nice to have a one-stop shop, to not have to figure out which door you go in, who you go see for which thing. You come to one location and we're able to help you navigate that.
In the case of any personal emergency, both the Counseling Center and the Center for Cura Personalis are able to provide immediate support and help students plan future counseling sessions. Doug Taylor, GUTV.
If you think you might need help with any sort of psychological issue, contact Student Health at studenthealth@gonzaga.edu or go to their offices at 704 East Sharp. In case of an emergency, Spokane has a first call for help hotline that is active 24/7 at 509-838-4428. We can't say it enough. Mind, body, and spirit are all equally important factors in mental health, and balancing all of those amid the ups and downs of life can be a challenge. But what's cool is that everyone has their own unique way of doing it. Let's head over again to the Apila Suite to learn a little more about balancing from our social media correspondent, Lauren Banus. Lauren?
Thanks, Caroline. We really buy into this idea that the Jesuits put forward about cura personalis, caring for the whole person. And that idea ties into the fact that mental health and physical health can't be separated. So, to find out how some of our Gonzaga students and the Gonzaga community takes care of their mind, body, and spirit, we sent out a Twitter request to find out what they do. Let's check out what we got. We were lucky enough to get a lot of really great tweets from the Gonzaga Health and Counseling Center, so we'll have a series of those that we'll read through. Here's the first one we got. To set aside time to do the things that you love. Don't let your schedule get so full that there's no time for fun. This is really great advice from the Counseling Center. It's really easy to get bogged down in work and school and everything we have to do, and so it's important to take time for yourself and make sure that you're really taking care of all aspects of being a healthy person. Next, we have a tweet about maintaining good sleep. Maintaining good sleep habits is a great way to take care of your whole self. Another really easy thing to forget as a college student, sleep is often the first thing that we push to the side when we need to do other things. If you don't get enough sleep, you're not going to be a healthy person overall, mentally or physically. So make sure that you're taking time to sleep. Next, we have a tweet from the Gonzaga First Year Experience Program. They said, "We enjoy catching up with our orientation small group leaders, playing Zag intramurals, and visiting Gonzaga Human." Thank you for sending that in, First Year Experience Program. It's really great to take time to get involved in the things that you like, whether that's sports or with Human or whatever it is. Taking time to take care of yourself is really important, so we're glad that the First Year Experience Program is really pushing that out to all of our first year students. Next up, another wonderful tweet from the Health and Counseling Center. They said, "There are many benefits to regular exercise. It helps with both physical and mental health." Kind of tying in with what the First Year Experience Program tweeted at us, taking time to get active is a good way to keep yourself mentally healthy. If you're sitting inside in front of a computer all day long, it's really easy to kind of get tied down in all of that. So great that you're advising people to go outside and get active. And finally, our last tweet from the Health Center, of all the wonderful things they've said, they ended it on this note. Another way to care for yourself, contribute to your community. Volunteering on or off campus is good for the mind, body, and spirit. Again, like Caroline said earlier, this idea of being men and women for others that the Jesuits put out there is a great way to support a healthy state of mentality. If you're not getting out there and interacting with other people, it could be really easy to kind of get caught up in the mundane aspects of everyday life. Thank you to everyone who tweeted in. We really appreciate it. It really enhanced the approach that we're taking to mental health, and it's great to hear different ways that people take care of themselves. After the break, we'll sit down with current student Andy Newman and nursing professor and mental health counselor, Professor Jennifer Miller. I'm Lauren Banus. You're watching GUTV.
May your past be the sound of your feet upon the ground. Carry on.
Good.
Hi. How are you?
Good.
Hi.
Good.
Yeah. Yeah. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
No, really. How are you?
Well, I'm studying for two tests I have tomorrow, which is kind of unfortunate, but I'm looking forward to the weekend. I'm going on a mountaineering trip, and that's going to be so much fun. We have to leave at...
I want to be a well-respected actor.
I want to be a therapist.
I want to be a supermodel.
I want to be a history teacher.
I want to climb mountains in New Zealand.
I want to change the world through education of young minds.
I want to be an artist for, I don't know, but I just want to be an artist.
I want to be a marine biologist.
I want to be a doctor and save lives.
Good morning,
beautiful.
Hey, I like your smile.
Great job. Keep up the good work.
Hey, your shirt looks really good on you.
And this here is the kindest girl on Gonzaga's campus. You're the best. I love GU.
Anybody stay for the test?
God, yeah, I'm gonna start studying right now. Thanks for reminding me.
There's a darkness upon me that's flooded. Welcome back to GUTV. I'm Caroline Rourke. Tonight we're joined by two very special guests who each have a personal connection to mental health issues. Earlier this week, I got the chance to have a little chat with them about the big picture chat we all should be having. September was National Suicide Prevention Month, and Senior Andy Newman had a few things to say about the anxiety and stress that often play a role in mental health problems.
Everyone goes through it, but no one wants to acknowledge it because it makes them seem weak or small or something like that.
In a letter to the Gonzaga Bulletin, Andy shared his personal experience with anxiety, depression, and suicidal ideations, and how he discussed how important it is to initiate these conversations, a step that nursing professor Jennifer Miller says is not easy to take.
For anyone to come forward with any health condition takes tremendous courage, and I would say in particular somebody that might be struggling with mental health issues or problems.
One voice, one story is all it takes to bring students and faculty together to start talking about a problem that so heavily impacts us all. Before he graduates, Andy hopes to keep up the change.
I mean, I've personally been thinking a lot about it, and I just kind of hope that there's maybe a shift in the culture on campus. So yeah, I hope in my time left, I have 6 months left till graduation, it's just that I hope people don't hide their struggles, I guess.
We couldn't agree more. So let's get this conversation started. Professor Miller, Andy, thank you so much for joining us today. I am really looking forward to talking to you guys about mental health and the way that it impacts us all.
It's my pleasure.
Andy, let's just start with you. What prompted you to write that letter to the Bulletin?
My older brother was a senior at Portland last year when three or four of the UP students lost their battles with mental illness and committed suicide. And one of my best friends from high school goes there. And so he started the Active Minds Club down at the University of Portland, where they're kind of trying to destigmatize the issues around mental illness and what mental illness means and what it means if you have it. And I'd been talking to him a little bit, and I knew that September was National Suicide Prevention Month. So I figured instead of reacting to a situation like the University of Portland unfortunately had to, we should be proactive and try and start a conversation before something like that happens.
Absolutely. And Professor Miller, now you have mentioned us before that your dissertation concerns this issue pretty closely. Will you explain a little bit about that?
Yes, I'm happy to do that. I became really intrigued by the topic of suicide prevention, largely because of my own professional work, but also my work with nursing students who do work with patients or individuals that are at risk for suicide. And so my dissertation topic, which is my doctoral study, it is around the experiences of student nurses that are caring for patients at risk for suicide.
And what could you summarize those experiences from what you found so far?
Mm-hmm. Well, the thing that was really interesting that I found is I think a lot of individuals in society will tend to think that mental health issues only arise on a psychiatric unit, as far as when we're talking about settings of care, healthcare. But actually, that couldn't be further from the truth. most of the students that came forward and were willing to share their stories with me, they had experiences with patients that were at risk for suicide that actually were on medical floors or on surgical floors or even on pediatric units. And so that really got me thinking more about, you know, I mean, it really impressed upon me how important it is that we address mental health concerns in any setting of care, and that my students really develop a skill set to work with individuals that might have mental health problems, no matter where they end up working as a nurse.
Yeah, it's funny, you know, the stereotypes that are perpetuated discriminate against people who have mental illness, but mental illness does not discriminate in any demographic of people. Everybody is affected by it. I think
Absolutely.
That's an interesting thing to keep in mind. Andy, you, in your article, you've got this really great quote here. You say, every student has highs and lows that they deal with each day, and counseling is a routine way to work those problems out as privately as you wish. So why do so many people avoid treatment, do you think? Why do so many people avoid taking the step to seek counseling?
I mean, I can only speak for myself personally, but for a long time, I didn't see myself as someone who needed counseling, who could work out their own problems. I mean, I am a pretty stubborn person, but like I always imagined that I'd be able to kind of just like climb out of whatever is putting me down. It's kind of like when you're physically sick, you can just kind of like work through it like naturally. You don't need to go, or like sometimes you do need to go to the doctor, but sometimes you just don't want to. And so I thought that I could work through it the best I could naturally. But I mean, sometimes you have to come to the realization that it's okay to go get help and like go talk to someone who has professional experience and can help you deal with what you're going through. And I think there's just this stigma around it where you just don't want to talk about it with other people. It's such a downer if you have to bring it up in conversation, that it's not something that's said like, oh no, don't talk about that. But mm-hmm. it's something that I think our society perpetuates, this idea that like, don't talk about it. Like it's weird, and you never, like, everyone has highs and lows, yeah, but like I don't want to know your lows, like I just want to know your highs, type of thing.
Absolutely. Professor Miller, so you obviously look at this through the lens of professionalism, and Andy has seen it through his personal experience, but what about someone who is a bystander? What can they do?
That's a great question. And I would say it's important to understand that, you know, anyone could encounter someone that is struggling with mental health problems. And so I think just understanding that it could be anyone, really. And if you notice something, or you're concerned about someone, or you notice that their behavior changes, for example, some of the things that we often see that could be early signs is we see individuals that have problems with sleep. Like maybe before they were sleeping okay, but now they're not sleeping so well. They're either sleeping too much or not enough. Or sometimes we will see changes in appetite. I don't know if you experienced any of those things, but sometimes individuals will either have an appetite that will increase or decrease. Also, we also will tend to see at times social withdrawal, because it does take a lot of energy for people to be around people when they're not feeling well. And so sometimes what we'll see people do is that are struggling is they'll withdraw and they'll kind of keep to themselves. And kind of, I don't know if you experienced any of that, Andy, in any of your, you know, times that you've been kind of at your low points. Was that something that was accurate for you?
Yeah, no, definitely. I think it's like the one point that I can actually pinpoint that kind of happening was the summer between my sophomore and junior year, where I was moving into a house and I was playing soccer here, so I was working out and playing and doing all that, and I definitely noticed this drop in an appetite. For someone who was working out and running every day and practicing, I should have been eating way more than I was, and luckily I had trainers here who would notice things like that, and so it never was like a conscious decision to stop. It was just like, well, I'm just never really hungry. Mm-hmm. It kind of just is what it is, and you never realize it until later, but mm-hmm. I definitely experienced that.
Yeah, it can be very insidious, and I guess I'm kind of giving the roundabout way to answer your question, but I think knowing what some of those early warning signs are, mm-hmm. Anyone can recognize some of those early warning signs. I think people also sometimes when they're really depressed, they'll report feeling just fatigued a lot, just tired all the time. But if you notice a change in a friend, an acquaintance, a family member, someone, ask them if they're doing okay. Hey, you seem different. Are you okay? What's going on with you? And really listen to their story. And I think recognizing those signs and then having the courage to say, you know, you seem like you're really struggling. Would you be willing to talk to someone? Or how can I help you connect with more support? I think it takes courage to ask those questions and to follow up and to really take the time to listen to their story. I think that those are some early steps that anyone can take.
You're right. I think that is. I think that's the most important thing that we can do is to just listen and to speak up. Unfortunately, we are all out of time for this interview, but thank you guys so much. I know I learned a ton and can definitely implement that in the future. Thank you all for watching GUTV tonight, and stay tuned next time on November 23rd for a special on students at Gonzaga with some hidden talents that make them pretty neat. I'm Caroline Rourke. You're watching GUTV.
Cold is the winter. It freezes your already cold mind. Already cold, cold mind. And death is at your doorstep, and it will steal your innocence. But it will not steal your substance. But you are not.